So good evening to everyone. On behalf of All India Educators Forum, it is my privilege to welcome you and very happy that Manisha ma'am, she's a PGT chemistry from Matade and a resource person with NCRT. And she has spared her valuable Sunday evening for this, for our educators. And the topic chosen is so relevant, experiential learning, and one of the things which every educator should be using there in their classrooms. So very happy that the topic is being discussed, and I'm sure the chemistry teachers who have gathered in large numbers are really going to benefit from this session. So thank you, Manisha ma'am, and it's over to you.
Thank you so much. So I welcome you all. Thank you. Thank you for joining me today, this evening, especially on a day of Father's Day. So all the fathers out there, I wish you a very, very happy Father's Day, and even to mothers, because some of the mothers play the role of father as well. So it's a happy day. So I'll just share my screen. I'll be very happy if one of you can just confirm whether my screen is visible, and I'll be happy. I'll just share. I hope it's visible.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. So once again, good evening, everyone. I am here to discuss a very, very important concept. And believe me, as a teacher, I feel this concept to be very, very close to my heart. Because somewhere we have been, you know, talking about something which is called experiential learning, something which is called learning by doing, something where we say that students should experience and learn by themselves. But how can we implement experiential learning in classroom? So I am Manisha Sharma, as Matthew sir has already introduced me. I'm PGT Chemistry in Matade School. I'm an NCRT resource person and now AIEF resource person as well. All thanks to Matthew sir for that. So when this new NEP 2020 came in last year, it was a big revolution in our teaching faculty and, you know, industry, education industry. And we realized that it actually has a lot of, you know, variations and a lot of challenges. We were already going through a few challenges, transitioning from the offline classes to online classes, and then suddenly this policy came into existence. So the key factors of this new education policy were majorly the hands-on training. And somewhere you were like, how are we going to do that? Because at times as science teachers, most of the times we are demonstrating the activities or the experiments to our children. I personally feel that the real hands-on training that the science students do is only when they reach class 10, 11, and 12. Before that, we make them do certain practicals, but most of the practicals are demonstration-based. With a lot of advancement in technologies, we do have those smart boards where the children are observing these practicals happening, the changes happening, and they understand and do. So somewhere that hands-on training was missing, and that's why it was included. Second thing was the sports integration. I actually favor that because I have been into sports in my school days, even in my college days. And I really used to not understand that how being a science student, I should not play sports. Because, you know, every time I used to ask my parents or, you know, even my teachers that I want to go for a basketball match, they would probably tell me, no, you have to study physics, or probably you have a physics coaching, or you have to go for chemistry classes. So somewhere when we talk of sports integration, I feel that sports somewhere becomes restricted to the junior classes. And, you know, gradually when the students reach up to the middle school or higher secondary, I'm not commenting on anything. Please take it as my own experiential learning, like my own experiences. I feel that students somewhere get distracted or diverted from the sports part. And, you know, they get into that zone where they are only studying and studying and studying. even right now you must be observing CBSE and Ministry of Education keep on, you know, sending those mails where we are asked to keep our children active, the Fit India movement that we had, because they know they are opening their laptops and mobile phones, sitting in front of the screen and doing no physical activity. So how to integrate these studies with the sports part, I think that was a very, very important point. Next was the art integration. Honestly, I was very bad at art when I was a student. So for me, art was something, those brushes, those strokes, those lines. And believe me, whenever I had to draw biology, you know, diagrams, it was a tough time for me. So I never enjoyed art. But now I feel that no, art integration is very, very important and very, very interesting. I'll be sharing how I integrated art in my chemistry classes. And probably you can share yours as well. Mr. Ram has annotated. I'll just... And the fourth part was the storytelling. The best, best part, and probably all of us love to hear stories. Even at this point of time, if somebody is going to tell you the story, I think we would be happy to hear these stories. So why not these students? They are pretty much interested in all these things. And when we can share the concepts in form of stories, I think that's going to be a very incredible thing. So these were major NEP points. And this led to something which is called, I'll just... the annotation that has been done. Okay. So the NEP 2020 was basically nothing but transitioning from the rote learning, memorization and cramming to internalization and experiential learning. When we talk of experiential learning, it is very important that we understand what experiential learning actually means. So there's a picture which I believe is worth a thousand words. No offenses. It is just a picture related to mathematics. It could have been a picture related to physics, chemistry, bio, anything. But you know, at times students feel, where am I going to use these concepts? Even we as teachers must be, you know, thinking where the student is going to use this concept, because somewhere we could not relate it to their daily life. We could not give them enough experience to implement what they learned. And experiential learning is all about this. There can be a few concepts. I'm not saying that every concept can be introduced through experiential learning. There can be some concepts where, you know, you will have to tell them that, no, you have to learn it. No, you have to understand it. But majority of the concepts, I personally feel, can be done through experiential learning within the same stipulated time that you were already using earlier. The man behind this theory was David Kolb in 1984. I don't want my audience to remain, like statues. So probably I'll ask, how many of you were born then? Honestly, I wasn't born in 1984. Can you just raise your hands and tell me how many of you were born during this time when David Kolb first introduced this theory on experiential learning? Let me see how many of us were there. Okay, so I was born in 1984. Okay. So Dipti ma'am, you and David Kolb's theory are born together. So 11 participants raised hand. So you see, many of us were even not born then. And many of us, of course, were born then. So David Kolb gave this theory. Thank you so much, participants. David Kolb gave this theory and he said, learning is a process whereby knowledge is created through the transformation of experience. And I think it is very much true then. You know, I'd say almost 35, 36 years back, this theory coming into existence is something very, very much revolutionary. So let us go ahead and see what experiential learning basically is. And then we will understand how we are going to implement it in the classroom. Okay. So all we need to know about experiential learning is that it definitely combines direct experience with focused reflection. What do I mean by focused reflection? See, since you are doing things yourselves, of course, you will have your own reflections. You will have your own feedbacks. You will have your own experiences. Your experiences might be positive. Your experiences might be negative, but they are your experiences. And they are definitely giving rise to some kind of conclusions, some kind of experiences, some kind of consequences. Like suppose if I am conducting a webinar, probably my webinar might not be a successful one, but I'll get an experience. I get to know that these were the points that I could not do well because of which my webinar was not good. Or probably these were the points which were very, very good and that's why everyone liked my webinar. And that is what is the beauty behind the reflective part of this kind of learning. And it is very, very much important that the reflections have to be focused. It is also very much interesting to know that it builds on past knowledge and experiences. I'll share a very, very small incident of my own life. I was not very much into cooking and all as a young woman. And, you know, as a science student, also my father used to always comment. I was born and brought up in a joint family. So my family and my father used to tell me that, you know, she's a science student, usko padhne do, disturb mat karo. And, you know, let her do the things. Once she's of the age, she will learn cooking and everything. So I was not interested in all of them. Aisa nahi ki I didn't like cooking or, you know, I had some problem. But probably I was not, you know, into cooking to an extent. But gradually I started developing that interest all thanks to my grandmother because she used to see the Tarla Dalals and Sanjeev Kapoor's program. And I used to see and I used to think, why cannot I make it? And, you know, gradually these experiences and this knowledge enabled me to learn cooking. So similarly, when a student has some past knowledge or experience about a subject, when somebody says, I hate physics, I hate chemistry, that's because probably they have some experience where they do not like the subject. Because they are very, very frightful about the concept. Because they do not understand the concept well. Most of the time, students do not like physics much because they are not able to relate to the concept, because they are not able to relate to the problems. And also, the actual involvement that we are talking about enables them to construct their ideas. Here, I would like to contrast between the active learning and the passive learning. Most of the times, we encourage passive learning in spite of active learning without even knowing that. It's unintentional. I'm not saying it's intentional. It's unintentional. Maybe because the management wants you to finish the syllabus on time. Maybe there are some other restrictions. But, you know, somewhere we are like, we're just coming, opening, telling them this, and tell them. Recently, I had an interaction with one of the students. I'll not name the school. He's a science student. Recently got into science stream and he got into science because he loved physics. And he told me that, ma'am, I'm no longer interested in science stream. It's been only 20 days that I have been in this stream and I have started feeling like rejecting the stream. That's because he shared that the teacher is taking the online class, sharing the PDF, just going one by one, you know, the PDF and asking the students to read the chapter on their own. So they feel that lack of connectivity with the subject. And that is why they do not feel like understanding the concept. These are just examples, of course, because I'm doing experiential learning, I'm sharing these examples with you because that's how students feel. And that's how they start telling that they do not like the subject anymore. The key factors to experiential learning is that it makes learning relatable and meaningful. As the poster initially said, where am I going to use these concepts? So if we are able to tell them how they can relate the concept with their actual, you know, situations and make them more meaningful, they would probably understand that. For example, even if we are telling them something about polymers or chemistry in everyday life, and we quote some real life examples and maybe give them some definitions and examples of the antacids that we are using, or maybe the analgesics, or maybe the antiseptics, probably students would feel more interested in the subject and more interested in the concept. Probably next time when he or she is going through the concept, he'll go through and go around the entire house and search for the medicines and see what the composition of the medicine is. Another is increasing the effectiveness of learning. since we are talking about active and passive learning, if we can just coordinate our learning from the passive thing to active thing, I think effectiveness would definitely be increased. And relating it to the daily life examples would definitely make the concept more effective. Linking theory to practice. I quote a very small examples, like if you're teaching adaptation to students. Now, how do human beings adapt to the situations, like how we have started adapting to the mask culture and the sanitizer culture? So if you're telling the 6th, 7th standard children about adapting to the extreme conditions, extreme weather, tell them to wear a strong, you know, very warm jacket during this time. And probably they'll say, ma'am, we are sweating. It's very hot. We can't stay here for very long. It's very problematic. And that's how they will understand how we are adapting. How, whenever you are coming out from a bright sunlight to a dark room, how your eyes are adapting to it. So if you ask them to do it, probably they will be able to understand how the conceptual part, the theoretical part can be included or can be linked with the daily life examples. It definitely increases the participants' engagement. Why? Because they're doing it themselves. They're experiencing it themselves. So when they're experiencing it themselves, then definitely they are having a lot of engagement, excitement, and a lot of relatability with the concept. And also it assists in memory retention. I quote the example of this movie, which is called Drishyam. It's a South Indian movie, but then was remade in the Bollywood with Ajay Devgan as the lead role, where this man, the character, is actually making his family go through the situations themselves, and that's how they are reporting it because they lived each and every moment and incident. So when the child has done things themselves, he or she will understand and will always have it in the memory. Now, the basic explorers behind this topic were John Dewey, Kurt Hahn, Kurt Lewin, and Jean Piaget. They were the men behind the theory, but of course, the main head of the department was David Kolb. And so we need to also understand what is Kolb's learning cycle before we go and understand what are the strategies that I'm going to suggest to you. So the Kolb cycle looks like this, probably everyone has seen this, where we say that it's a cycle. I personally feel that it's a vicious cycle where, you know, everything is going here to there and, you know, you start from concrete experience, go to reflective observation, then abstract conceptualization, active experimentation, and so on and so forth. So if you have to actually tell, can somebody quickly write it in the chat box and tell me what exactly you feel about concrete experience? What do you think it should be? I'll open my chat box also. Meanwhile, what can this concrete experience be? Anyone?
I'm waiting.
Hands on. Okay. Personal experiences in some activity. Agreed. When there is hands on. Yes. So it's very much true that, yes, we are talking about the hands-on thing. So the concrete experience is something where you are having the hands-on experience and you are learning from it. And somebody tell me, what is reflective observation? What do you think is reflective observation?
Good evening, Manisha, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Reflective observation means when a child reaches to certain concept, there's a experience behind it. It is just the tip of the iceberg which you observe what is happening. The rest, everything what has happened earlier is the result of that particular result.
Right. So basically the observations or, you know, the things that we have understood from the hands-on experience that we had. So the reflections on the situations, and that's how we are forming an opinion about it, isn't it? Yeah. So
yes,
next
ma'am.
Thing is abstract conceptualization, where we are modifying an existing concept. So it can be an abstract concept or any concept that we are discussing. And lastly is active experimentation. Can somebody tell me one or two word for active experimentation, not a sentence, but just one or two words. Active experimentation, just one or two words, probably. A phrase maybe which can define active experimentation, demonstration, implementation, self-involvement.
Hidden trial.
Yeah, and I call it risk-taking. I call it risk-taking because we are actually, whatever we have experienced, whatever we have at our reflections, we are ultimately putting it into active experimentation. So yes, very rightly pointed that yes, it is hit and trial, and that's how the learner is applying what he has learned. So I hope you people are pretty clear with these points on Kolbe's law. I am muting everyone because I think somebody is... I have allowed you to unmute whenever needed. So I have an activity for all of you, and I'll be giving you a situation, and you have to tell me which situation is reflecting which part of Kolbe's theory. Okay, so we are all about to ride a bicycle. We are actually learning to ride a bicycle, and there are 4 points: receiving practical tips and techniques from an expert, observing someone else ride the bicycle, understanding the theory behind the cycling concept, and jumping onto the bicycle and hitting the road straight away. So can somebody tell me, receiving practical tips and techniques from an expert should come into which category? I'm talking about only 1 point at a time. So receiving practical tips and techniques from an expert should come in which category of Kolbe's theory? Should it be active experimentation or reflective observation? What should this be?
Concrete. If somebody...
Concrete experience. Yes, very well said. It is going to be concrete experience because the person is actually understanding how to ride a bicycle. Acha, if we are saying observing someone else ride the bicycle, then what should this be? You can unmute yourself and tell me, because then I have to open the chat box also. Though I can do that. Observing, reflective observation.
Reflective.
Okay. And jumping onto the bicycle and hitting the road straight away.
Experiment.
Can you please mute him?
Yes, sir.
Actually, background noise is...
Yes, sir. I have muted everyone. I have muted everyone, sir. I'm so sorry. Yeah, so that's absolutely correct. Learning to ride a bicycle, and this is what we understand. So that's how we understand the concept of Kolb's theory. And I'll be now going ahead and exploring, making you explore the experiential learning, which is absolutely a pedagogy. Students are our gods and everything that you would like to say. So the theory or the process is a very, very much student-centric. The students are active learners, and they are in full control of what they are learning. And so they are able to understand things, reflect on them critically, think, evaluate themselves, self-assessment, everything is happening. And it's definitely not about conducting a lot of activities. So it's quite possible that you conduct only one activity in a week or maybe fortnightly. It's not about conducting the activities every day, but probably whatever activity you are conducting has to implement all of these things where the students are centered. During these situations, field trips and excursions are not happening, but we do have some alternate solutions to that also, which I'll be giving. And experiential learning finally leads to the active learning, changes the mindset, of course, and promotes a lot of deep understanding and concept retention because memory is participating there. So now we'll understand what all techniques can we use to understand the experiential learning or to implement it in the classroom. Field trips, narrative, storytelling, conducting experiments, simulations, games, role play, model building, survey, and case studies. So one by one, I'll be discussing all of these. And in case you have any suggestions or in case you have more ideas, you have implemented anything else beyond this, you're most welcome to write it in the chat box. I go ahead and we will discuss the field trips. As I said, field trips are no longer existing because of COVID situation, and we are no longer taking our kids out. But there are these options of virtual field trips. So if you can search it on Google and you go for some virtual museums, virtual zoos, you will get a lot of ideas where you can enable your students to explore these places. Even, you know, while they are sitting at their homes, they can explore Paris Museum and Scotland Zoo and all of these museums and all. Now, how these field trips are helping you? For some of the techniques, I'll be implementing the four points of the Kolb's theory, and you can understand it that way. Like for field trips, if you are actually taking them for some field trips, be it virtual, be it real, you are providing them with some kind of concrete experience because they are imagining and, you know, looking at the things and learning those facts. Even, you know, you can have reflective observation when you are guiding your students to research what they understood. For example, you took them for a science museum trip and you are asking them to observe a fossil. So just taking them to the museum is giving them a concrete experience because they are watching or observing a lot of things. Now you are asking them to think from the perspective of a fossil maybe, or probably somebody who is researching on fossils and trying to figure out what fossils are made up of, what are vestigial organs, analogous, and all of these organs that we talk about in heredity and evolution. So that is going to be the reflective observation. Then also you can ask them to go back home and research on what they were thinking. Probably what they were thinking was something very abstract. But asking them to research will definitely give them that conceptualization of their abstract thought, of enabling them to know that what they actually were thinking was justifiable or not. And lastly, if they can create something on that basis, maybe they can create a model of a fossil. Maybe they can join a lot of straws and create a fossil. Maybe they can show some of the organs that, you know, they felt could have been present but were absent. And that will give them the feel, or that will give them the understanding about the active experimentation. Second great technique is narrative, which is great stories. I am a huge fan of Marie Curie. So I often share stories of Marie Curie and how she... during that time, when research was so much man-dominated, she was the only female then to research and, you know, sit and interact and discuss things with so many, great scientists. So I often tell these stories to my students. But for the narrative part, I feel that Carbon, I usually take the example of Carbon. I'll also share one comic with you towards the end of the webinar, which is going to tell you the narrative thing. So I often tell them the stories on the scientist and all, which can definitely come in storytelling. But here in the narrative part, I take some random examples. And Carbon is my one of the favorite examples because Carbon and its compounds, they study in class 10. Then in class 11, we are telling them hydrocarbons. We are telling them about the saturation and saturated compounds. And we are telling them all these physical properties and reactions. So just to tell them and, you know, maybe creating a play to demonstrate how carbon is, you know, possessing all these properties, how it functions, is concrete experience. Also telling them to think from the perspective of carbon, because carbon is someone who is tetravalent. So he is such a good and nice friend that it can donate 4 electrons and it can gain also the 4 electrons. So asking students to think from the perspective of a carbon and telling them how would they feel if they themselves are carbon, whether they will be able to donate 4 electrons to somebody or whether they will be able to accept 4 electrons from somebody, will give them this reflective observation. Under extreme circumstances, because carbon has got a lot of isotopes and carbon also has got a lot of allotropes. So telling them that difference between graphite, diamond, Buckminster fullerene, And, you know, asking them to reflect on their properties. Why are they different? Why is one allotrope amorphous? Another allotrope is crystalline. What is the difference between the forces? Reflecting all of that behavior that they have understood from concrete experience and reflective observation and applying them is going to help them for abstract conceptualization. And ultimately, not telling them anything, not giving them any rules for making these dot structures, telling them why is it going to be unsaturated, why alkene formation, just let them play with the compound or let them play with the element. Just tell them, make it yourself. You find out how many electrons are valence and how the bonding is going to happen. In class 9, whenever we are telling them about magnesium and sulfate, just let them know why magnesium is going to have +2 charge. So all of that can be done and the students will learn by themselves, and probably we do not have to tell them that wahan se electron uthao, udhar leke jao, udhar se electron idhar leke jao. And for them, dot and cross structures, which was earlier the concept, now we are using just dot structure, will become very, very feasible and easy. Storytelling is one of my favorite activity and of course a very, very powerful tool to enhance and impart concepts. But for that, I personally feel that there are a few things that we should always keep in mind. Whenever we are telling a story, it's very important to plan your story because we are not telling them any panchtantra or ready-made story. You have to cook these stories. You have to make a background that how the story is to be created. For example, if I am supposed to tell them how the Newton's law of motion came into existence, or probably what are the theories of structure of atom, I will have to cook up these stories, or how the periodic table came into existence. So we need to plan our stories because our stories are not ready-made. We can always use this language that students understand. So even if you wish to go for bilingual thing, it's absolutely okay. It is okay. Because sometimes to generate that interest, kabhi kabhi aapko apna language change karna padega. Okay. Next thing that the point is, maintain the eye contact. Because we are in the online system, I'm sure you must have attended a lot of webinars where, you know, you must have learned this and you must have heard it. It's very important to maintain that eye contact because students are very smart. They get to know that the teacher's eye contact is not there and it becomes very easy for them to vanish. So that is important. Modulation of voice is also important because when we are definitely handling the students of 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, they want a sudden excitement and a sudden slowing of the voice. So that voice modulation is very, very much important. Otherwise, they'll sleep. Of course, when we are modulating the voice, the pauses at those critical moments are very, very, very important. Why is it important? Because we are narrating the story like a movie. We are teaching generation, you know, this 21st century generation. And we need to tell them, I'm sorry, there's a spelling mistake. It has to be story. So we need to narrate this story like a movie and then only they'll be interested. Otherwise, they'll feel, oh, ma'am, we are not junior level kids where you are telling us this story. The interaction is also encouraged there. Sound effects, if you are very good in technology and even if you feel that you can have those boom bam thing coming up, the storytelling sessions become very, very interesting. The next technique that we have is conducting experiment. As science teachers, we all have a, you know, soft corner for conducting the experiments. I am just muting everyone and I'm not allowing anyone to unmute themselves. In case you have any issue, please write it in the chat box, because I think okay. So conducting experiments, of course, it's a trial and error procedure, and since 15 months I feel we all have found out our own ways of conducting the experiments. OLabs has been one of the app where we are conducting the virtual labs and virtual experiments because we are not able to conduct any real-time experiments. I have also explored another app, which is Chem Collective. If you are very much interested and if you are a chemistry teacher, you can go for this Chem Collective app. they just conducted a training session with CBSC, and I think there is another session lined up for towards the end of this month. So Chem Collective is also one of the virtual lab where you can use the experimentation part. I personally felt that Chem Collective has more options than OLABs, but it is only for chemistry. And while OLABs gives you the variety of physics, biochemistry, all the practicals. So conducting experiments, I'm not telling you how to conduct the experiments, but I'm just telling you that how in the virtual scenario, we can conduct experiments and enable our students to understand them well. So when we can just tell them or make them understand what the experiment is all about, because the present 12th batch that we have not been into lab at all. I personally feel it because they started their class 11th online. Now their class 12th is also happening online. They do not have any idea about the salt analysis, titration till class 10. They have just done, you know, a few experiments, that too very easy ones like pH meter and, you know, soap and froth formation, etc., etc. So it is important for them to understand what the experiment is all about. Let them pose a question. Let them research the topic themselves. Let them know what they are going to understand today. Let them think that what, you know, the practical is going to give them. Or probably let them design their own experiment. If you really want them to, you know, understand a particular concept, or even if you just want them to dissect a flower or a leaf, let them do it themselves. Let them figure out उन्होंने कितना गलत किया कितना सही किया. Probably initially वो stamens को गलत काट देंगे, या you know they might dissect the flower absolutely wrong, but they'll understand and they'll feel good about it because they did it themselves. Let them perform it. Let them collect the data or draw the inferences and conclusions. This can be anything. This can be creating a polymer themselves. This can be creating a soap at home. This can be creating their own sanitizers. Let them take aloe vera juice, ask them to mix it with some soap solution, shake it up, aloe vera and soap solution. If you have alcohol at your home, just ask them to, you know, add it, and your ready-made sanitizer is ready. So all of this thing is going to make them excited towards the subject and they'll feel better about it. One more thing which has come into, you know, science these days, especially in last 2-3 years, is simulations. Where, you know, things are working and students are able to imagine things in the 3D model or 3D, you know, form. I happened to attend this augmented reality course and I really liked it. I personally am using PHET simulations. If you can put it on the Google, you will get the link. Otherwise, there are a lot of simulations that are available. There are a lot of YouTube videos where you will see that the YouTube creators are using all these simulations to show how the digestive system looks like. How you can imagine an atom and a molecule. How when we say that a p orbital looks like this, why is it so? So when we are discussing simulations, it's very important that we conceptualize it. Like I made a simulation to show how a sun and earth has a connectivity and how earth rotates around the sun. So I had to conceptualize and I had to understand that I have to give it the rotation as well as revolution, because I have to show them the day and night change as well. And for that, I had to create an environment, because that's where I'm going to show them that simulation. Technology integration is, of course, important, because you cannot show 3D thing without any kind of technology. And assessing that simulation, whether it's working fine for your kids or not, is another part. Then debriefing and also finally evaluating whether the simulation that you created helped you in understanding or, you know, implementing all the learning outcomes that you had, is this cycle. So this is the simulation life cycle. Then the next technique is games. There are a lot of games that we have. Kahoot is one of the favorite games that my students love. And every week, Saturday class, we have a small session of Kahoot. And this Kahoot sometimes is not, you know, the concept based, but sometimes just to know how students feel about, there's some chat message. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for sharing the link. Okay. So Kahoot is one of this. And sometimes just to know what students feel about things, you can create your own Kahoot. So, you know, general cahoots can also be created. Paper pencil games are very, very much interested, where you can give them some jigsaw puzzle related to the subject. You can create your own crosswords, and students would love to have. Even word games. In word games, you can give them some hints and let them fill one word for that particular statement, and they will love it. Also, there is another app which is called Quizlet, which is a very, very successful app. So all of these I'm personally using. So I have shared it here. Whatever I am using, that only I'm sharing. So I have had a great experience in using all these games, and students feel, you know, that they are excited and they look forward. A day before, I'll tell tomorrow you are going to have a revision session through this, and they are excited and they come to the class, you know, in full strength. So what are these games doing? These games are definitely turning these students into problem solvers. They are self-assessing themselves, and so they are self-directed. They are, you know, these games are engaging them. They are competing with their peers. Like in Kahoot, you get that first, second, third position. So they know after every question, there is a position. So they know, oh, I was at first position. Now I am in the second position. So, you know, next time when they are answering next question, they are doing it at a faster speed so that, you know, they have that competition. And of course, it's a friendly competition. And also it is enabling the students to analyze. There is one more this thing, awesome science apps, which is the app, the link that I can, that you can see, and I can click on this link. This is a very, very interesting link. This is the link. I can write it and post it on the chat box. And in case you are interested, please go and check this. This is, you will get a lot of things here where you can, you know, just. So you can check this also. This is my, again, used one. So you can see it yourself. So I've shared the link in the box. You can check it. So a lot of apps and games related to the concepts are already there, and you can explore that. Let's go back to the next technique, which is the role play. Again, this role play thing is very, very interesting because, you know, you are enabling your students to show something. It can be individual, it can be a group activity, because we are conducting online classes, so you can have individual activity. One thing that I would suggest is, in my class, I have created some chemistry couples. Couples means I'm in a convent school, all the students are girls. So they are paired up. So they have a pair, and I call them chemistry couples. So every girl has a chemistry couple, and whatever activities at times I do is done in these chemistry couples. Sometimes I pair two or three couples together to make it a group activity. Sometimes I, you know, make one student out of the two students question something, and another is, you know, answering feedback thing. So these chemistry couples are fixed, and, you know, they are learning in that ways. So if you want to make such couples or pairs, you can also do that. So individual or group activity can be done. Topics can be given accordingly. The students are asked to select the situation, whatever situation. I usually do role plays when I am doing P block elements or S block elements, where I make them, you know, one of the element in each of the family. Suppose I'm doing alkali metals. So one of them will become lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. And then they are, you know, telling how one of the element is going to react with oxygen or nitrogen or, you know, other things. So they are selecting the situation. They are creating their own dialogues. Practicing it for some time, and then showing it in front of their class. Once they do it, the peers are automatically giving them the feedback, and at last, I am giving them the feedback on what they have done. So this role play thing is also, you know, helping us, you know, helping the teachers to get some feedback from the students, where we know whether the students have understood the concept or not. And this is the concept. Next, we have model building. I personally feel, because we get a lot of, you know, mails where, you know, the schools are having their exhibitions and we are asked to create the models. I somewhere feel that, you know, we are not able to give them correct guidance when it is about creating a science model. So we just ask them to create a science model without even emphasizing on how that model is going to be related to the real world. And so if we want to create a good science model, I feel that you know, connection with the real world is very, very important. Of course, it is based upon assumptions, and that's again a vicious cycle, because this conceptual model is based on some assumptions, which is giving you a working model, and then working model is giving you that conceptual model. I have also found and, you know, got to know that a lot of students, wherever they are given this model thing, buy it or, you know, ask some experienced or professional person to create these models for them, because they are no longer interested in creating the model, or probably they are not able to connect to this concept. So if we can just help them understand the creation of these science model, then I think it's going to be a good thing. Survey, I personally feel, is a very, very good thing. I personally take survey at the end of my end of year, every school year, from my students, though some of the teachers feel, why should a student evaluate a teacher? But I personally feel that that kind of feedback is very, very much interested, because that always helps us to grow, because that always helps us to know what students want, what students felt that, you know, this could have been correct. Even after every webinar, we are asked to fill a feedback form. Why? Because the organizer or whoever is hosting the webinar wants to know what went wrong. So survey is something which is very, very important. It is important to include only necessary questions. Don't give them big questions and, you know, continuous questions. So ask one question at a time. Keep it short and simple. Avoid using jargons, you know, unnecessarily, which the student, you know, people or students don't like. This can be for both the ways. You can ask it from the students, and students can also create it, you know, to know something from other people. Like suppose they are doing a research on COVID-19. So they can create their own survey. Open-ended, close-ended, that you can always decide. You need to spend time to design your survey, because you can't just randomly put questions and do it. After you have conducted this survey, it is important to analyze it, compile the report, and conclude the plan of action. Next, we have case studies, which is again a very good problem-solving approach, which we have been, you know, doing, and CBSE has included in last 2 years as well. So in chemistry, we have got investigatory projects in class 12. So they are very much based on case studies, where the students are analyzing a particular situation. They are analyzing chocolates, they are analyzing ice creams. And I personally feel that students really like these investigatory projects, because they are learning something. And every time they get something, you know, some positive thing they get. Yes, some of my students have got something in chocolates and other stuff also. They feel very happy about it, because they feel whatever they have done is very, very much successful. So this is the step in conducting. Now, there are some reflection strategies apart from that, that I will just quickly share with you. These are the reflective strategies apart from what I have suggested. So you can ask your students to pair and share, where, you know, it's a very classical strategy that most of us must be doing. Layered text, if you want, I can share it on the group, because many of you are part, most of you are in the group, so I can share this document in the group that we have created. Tweet, because this is Generation X, you know, the 21st century kids. So they can tweet on whatever they feel. They can create their own page, account. Last year, my students created their own website, where they were putting all of those things that they were doing themselves. So the computer students helped them in programming and coding and all of those things. And so they had a website called Sanguine Lasses. Then exit tickets, exit slips, podcast is one of the thing that is, you know, coming up. They all are on Instagram. So Instagram has a lot of podcast happening. Brainstorming, Jigsaw, Prezi. Then you have checklists, KWL, what I know, what I want to know, and what I learned. I think it's a very, very important activity and strategy that we can always do. Storyboard, concept maps. Don't give them concept maps. Ask them to create their own concept maps. You taught them the chapter, you gave them all the activities, now ask them to create their own concept maps. Quick write, just give them two words, or maybe, you know, two phrases or a concept, and ask them to write what they feel about it in you know, some time, maybe 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 7 minutes, whatever you want to give them. Take and pass, exit cards, reflective essays, self-assessment, portfolio, video presentations. So all of that is going to definitely, you know, help them in understanding the concept. So I was just sharing one of the thing with you. I was telling you about the carbon activity. So if you can see, it's a comic thing that my students have created when I ask them to, you know, act as carbon. So here they are talking about oxygen. So oxygen, how it is reacting or behaving with hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, fluorine, magnesium, helium. It was a role play. They did it in the class. Everyone, you know, participated. One of the student was hydrogen, oxygen, chlorine, and carbon. And how they are, you know, acting. So with helium, how is it going to act? These were their dialogues. And so they gave the dialogues in the form of a cartoon character. So this is how helium and oxygen are reacting. How iron is going to react with oxygen. Then how it is going to react it with carbon, how hydrogen is acting with oxygen, with magnesium, how is it acting? So with magnesium, you know, the bond is being done and this all thing. So this is how, you know, you can implement all of these things. And I think there is some messages on the chat. Screen share not happening. Can you not see my screen? Only PPT is visible. Okay, okay. I'll just share it again. Sorry. Okay. I think now it should be visible. I think now it's visible. Yeah, okay. So I'm sorry. I was not aware that it is not visible to you. So this is what I was discussing. This is the carbon thing that I was discussing, the oxygen role play, iron, helium, hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen, and how they are reacting. So this is what I was discussing with helium, how it is reacting, the oxygen. We are talking about oxygen. With iron, how is it reacting? The carbon, how is it reacting? Hydrogen, how is it reacting? The words, the dialogues, these students have said these dialogues, and then they just, you know, wrote it in the cartoon thing for the submission and for the records. So how magnesium is running after the oxygen to catch it, because oxygen, magnesium wants to donate the electrons, and how, you know, school bus, the oxygen is sitting and how magnesium is reacting it with. This is how the dialogues were. So it became OMG. When magnesium reacted with oxygen, it became OMG. So it has to be MGO, but then just to create that laughter thing, it became OMG. So then the reaction is also given. Then how barium is reacting, and all of those things. So these were created by all these girls. They were part of the thing, and the role play was done, and that's how they have created. Also, that thing, I think that was also not shown to you. So I'll show it again. I'll share this reflective document thing with you all. And I was talking, I think my screen was not visible. So when I was telling about the strategies, these were the strategies that I was talking about. Pair, share, layer, text, all of these activities that I was talking about. I can share this document with you on the group, no worries. Before I conclude, I will just show a very, very small video, which is just 6 minutes. And I think that would, you know, solve all my, concerns and issues, or, you know, the content that I want to share with you. So I'll just share that also with you. It's a small video, but I'm sure it's worth watching. Share sound. It's a video of a school who is experimenting this experiential learning.
Run around!
Yes! Any module or a lesson plan normally starts with a...
Let's check the sound. Can somebody confirm whether the
audio activity is... It normally stimulates the student into the mode of something that they're going to do throughout the lesson plan. Also, it puts them into an active mode. You see,
is the voice okay, Apurva ma'am? Can you please confirm? Yes, acha, it's audible. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. I just
see that there's an active participation from all the students. Most of the starter activities would be, kinesthetic in nature, where there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of use of space and use of body. This also sets a context for, you know, something that they're going to do later as a concept as well. There's no students, you know, front benches, back benches. Everybody is included. Everybody is having fun. Everybody is enjoying. So starter activity basically is very, 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 very important part of the experiential learning that we just saw.
Imagine yourself to be a flying object and you're going to fly from one end of the class to the other, and the others are going to guess what flying object that particular student is personifying.
Now we'll divide the class into groups. Each group will go and pick up the object which you think can fly, and your time starts now. So group one will come here and will classify the objects.
This particular activity gives so much scope of processes and skills that the kids need to go through in the learning process.
Fly your airplanes into the air. Okay. After that, you go and take a measuring tape and you measure the length that your airplane has traveled.
Each group will be given a topic. You will research on the topic and you'll do presentation. I'm giving you the rubrics. On the basis of the rubrics, your presentation will be assessed.
Model that you have just made of your paper plane, and we are going to fly it again and analyze why there is a change in the distance traveled by the plane. So now I want you to sketch out an airplane on your notebook and mark out the forces that you think oppose the movement of the airplane or support the movement of the airplane.
So that's how they created their own model, and that's how, the teacher who is teaching them all these techniques is not a science teacher. She's an English teacher who is being given this responsibility to teach them how, you know, they can create their own paper planes and make them flight. And that time of flight, you know, that the children are supposed to learn, that can be learned. So I personally feel that, you know, all these experimentation part can be done without even, you know, wasting time and using that stipulated time. So that's all from my side. That was all that I could share. Before you leave and before I give a thank you, just let me share my screen once again so that I can thank Matthew sir and conclude my presentation. So this is experiential learning from my point of view. The absolute imagination, the absolute hands-on training. They did something which is very, very interesting, and I personally feel that all of us are basically experimenting experiential learning with ourselves also.
Be positive, and, don't worry, be happy.
Si baat, I will tell you, when I started into webinar thing, I actually did a risk thing, and it was an active experimentation for me. Honestly, I had no training, no clue. I was just attending a few webinars. It came to my mind that I have to take this webinar. Not today, but last year when I conducted my first webinar, I had no training.
We are going to review it under three headings.
I was doing everything single-handedly. And there were a lot of flaws, lot of problems, lot of issues.
future.
But still, I had that confidence that I will do it again and again and again.
So I really enjoyed the way the concepts were brought up.
For me, experiential learning, I started with active experimentation. Now you think that if you want to conduct any webinar or you want to implement all of this in your classroom, whether you want to follow for active experimentation, concrete experience, or anything that you like.
Actual
but
planes
keep trying
that
we have.
We learn a lot of technical stuff in actual learning, but right now we're also learning about teamwork, we're getting creative, we're getting imaginative. So we're learning life skills as well as the actual.
Thank you so much, Matthew, sir. Any questions, any queries, I would love to answer them. And before you leave, I'll just share the feedback link with you so that you can fill it and send it to me. And hopefully we'll get the certificates. I have linked my form with the certificate thing. So you will get the certificate. In case you do not get it, please message me. We are on the group. Any suggestions, anything that you would like me to change? Actually, I have just a minute. I'll change the chat settings. I'll just change them because everyone was unmuting themselves. Yeah, you can unmute yourself now. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manisha ma'am. Wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
In 1 hour short duration, so many aspects you brought about. And, many people ask, how do you become NCERT resource person, CBSE resource person? So we saw the quality today. So this is what it's all about. And earlier also you had done a session for NCERT. Wonderful session. I mean, a very compact session, but at the same time brought about so many aspects. Yeah. So, and without wasting so much of time, very professionally handled. And I think the participants will be very happy today after attending this session. So thank you once again for everything.
Any questions, any queries? Thank you so much, Matthew, sir. It is all because of your support that, we can do something like this because you give us this platform and you give us that strength, honestly. I'll be very honest. I messaged Matthew, sir, about 10 minutes, before the session. And so I said, sir, can you please join the webinar? I don't know. I just want you to be there. So it is all because of him. Thank you so much, sir.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Myself, Sonam Sahu, and yes, I just want to know that it is sometimes very difficult to tell about the student about the organic chemistry in Zoom platform. And I don't have the board. I'm teaching them through the notebooks if I have to tell them. So kindly please tell me that some websites where I can show them the structures.
Yes, yes, ma'am. You can go to PHET simulation. If you type it on PHET simulations, Google Pay, you will get, this app and it is, very friendly. Aap wahan pe kaam kar sakte hain. Also, if you really want them to know about the carbon double bond, triple bond and all of those things, I use clay. I use this modeling clay, no? And you can make multiple balls with them. Fix it in some, skewer or maybe those toothpicks and you can show them what carbon tetravalent bond is, how carbon double bond carbon can be shown, how carbon triple bond carbon can be shown and all of these structures, why carbon double bond carbon cannot be rotated along the axis. So when you show them, when you demonstrate it from this small activity, this is something that they can do it themselves also. So you can just guide them, show them once, and probably they will, do it themselves and they will know how it is reacting. Even nucleophilic reaction. Whenever I'm telling them haloalkanes or halovarenes, I have to tell them SN1, SN2 mechanism. So I make this, tetravalent and pentavalent thing. Also, I have these models, these chemistry models I have where I've got these multiple colored balls and the bonds that I have. If you are interested and if you want to invest money in it, then Amazon has it for 1,000 rupees, 1,200 also. A lot of models are available online. Some are costly also, depends whether you want to invest it or not. Otherwise, modeling clay works pretty well. Just modeling clay and these toothpicks will help you, resolve majority of your issues there. So that's a tried thing from my side. So I think you can also try.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, you said that instead of OLAB, we can also use another lab for chemistry. Will you please give the link, ma'am? what is
the Chem the Collective, ma'am? It's called Chem Collective.
Okay.
It's actually a software. It's a software. It's called Chem Collective. You have to just install this software. Initially, you will need a training, you know, somebody, you know, to tell you how to operate it. And, you know, you will understand it. Otherwise, there are some, you know, videos also available. So you can see the videos and try doing it yourself. So Chem Collective is the app. No, Shanti ma'am, I have no idea about physics, honestly, because I do not take the subject. So I have no idea about physics, but chemistry, I'm using Chem Collective and OLABS, two apps I'm using. OLABS, I personally feel that when I have to do the titration and all of those things, it is not enabling me to make my own solutions. I mean, there is a fixed concentration. I have to take that only. But in Chem Collective, I have this, you know, option of verifying and, you know, diluting my own solution. So if I have 1 molar and I wanted 0.01 molar, I can dilute it. So that way it's all. Yeah, Maitri ma'am has suggested that link also.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I tried to use simulations of OLABS, but you know, that is very restricted, like for salt analysis and all.
Yes.
So if you can please have one, you know, webinar for that. Like
Sure. If Matthew sir permits me, I will definitely conduct this session if sir permits me. But OLABS, yes, ma'am, it has restrictions. I have personally written it to OLABS team also, because, you know, we have to manage with whatever resources they have, you know, mentioned in their app. We can only do and use them only. Even salt analysis and other things, whatever they have, you know, given, hame wohi use karna padta hai. So wo ek thoda sa restriction hai. That is there. But yes, we can always conduct a webinar on simulation part, PHET simulations, Chem Collective, even OLABS, we can do that. No problem. Anything else? Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your feedback. Thank you so much for your appreciation. Please fill the form so that I can hand over your certificates to you. So I think we can call it off for the day. Thank you so much for joining in. We have a great week ahead. Thank you so much.